right. Now, as always, we have Clint Betts is here with us who helped pull this thing together. We're so excited. And it's really fun to let Clint introduce the speakers because he knows all the good stuff about what's going on behind the scenes. So, Clint Betts.
I love that I get an intro every week. It's pretty cool. Great speaker today. Thank you all for coming. Please give it up for Aaron Sconard for coming. How awesome is this? Yeah, that wasn't your intro. I was just giving you... You're going to get another applause once I'm done with the intro. President Holland's here. Give it up for President Holland. Ryan Crafts is here, which is just as important in my book. Ryan Crafts, Mary Crafts' son. Everybody know who Mary Crafts is? Anyway, get to know Ryan afterwards. So Aaron Sconard, CEO, Pluralsight, good friend of mine. He and I started something called START Foundation a little over a year ago to really kind of unite Utah's startup and tech community. And what that became was Silicon Slopes, as it now is. We got all the major CEOs and tech companies behind this organization. And that wouldn't have happened without Aaron's leadership. And he's just an amazing, amazing person, as you'll soon see. Please give it up for Pluralsight CEO, Aaron Sconard.
It is a pleasure to be with you today. How many of you want to start a company one day? How many of you want to create something amazing? There are some of you who don't want to create something amazing? Like, everyone here should want to create something amazing in your life. And I'm going to talk about some stuff that I've learned here today that leads to creating amazing things. And I'm going to focus on the business perspective in creating high growth, creating something that's growing, that's actually changing and impacting the world. But I want to start just by saying a few words about these people that are here. You know, Clint has done a lot of good for the Utah community. You know, he has really seen a possibility here in Utah that not a lot of people before him have seen. You know, that Utah could really be a leader in this country and even globally in tech innovation. You know, we have all the ingredients for that here within our wonderful state. And tech is the thing that creates amazing things here in this world. And Clint has seen the possibilities around that and has inspired a lot of people here in Utah to get aligned around that vision. And so this thing that we call Silicon Slopes is becoming a big thing in the world. And you're going to see a lot of unification from this year forward across all of the big Utah tech companies, all these billion-dollar companies in Utah, behind this vision. And it's to inspire all of you, you know, people sitting, all of you sitting in these chairs here today, to go create the next wave of companies that can create good here in Utah and across the world. And that's why we're doing it, because we really believe that Utah is a place for creation. So I just want you to think about that for a second. I want to recognize Clint for his role in that. Thank you, Clint. Give him a hand. He's an amazing guy. And there is no other university in the state of Utah that's thinking as innovatively about our future as UVU. And that's because of this man right here, President Holland. He really has a vision for what this can be. You know, he has a vision for what a university in Utah should be like that's really connected to the private industry, the business community, and the tech innovation that's happening around it. And I see that vision in him, and he's thinking very differently about it than anyone else that I've seen here in the state. And that's why you're experiencing what you're experiencing right now in this moment. That's why you have, you know, a dozen of the top CEOs in Utah coming here every week to be part of this amazing class. Like, that doesn't just happen. It happens because of vision. And you have vision that then, that you have imagination. Let's go further back. You have imagination of what the possibilities could be. And you start to see, like, what would it be like if we actually brought all these CEOs together into a class that touched all the students who are going to be the future entrepreneurs here in the state? And then all of a sudden it becomes a real possibility. And then it turns into creation. And here we are sitting here today and it's happening. And there's a theme here. I wanted to recognize both of them and acknowledge them for what they've done, because they're great examples of imagination turned into possibility, which turns into creation. And that's leadership in the end. That's the true essence of leadership, being able to see possibility and organize around it so that you can move people to a new place of creation. And that's a lot of what I'm going to talk about today. So thank you guys for your example to me and for what you're doing for all these people here today. And I want to then bring that into my discussion with you to help you see some new possibilities for yourselves. Like, if there's one thing I want you to walk away from this talk with, it's with the knowledge and the confidence that you can create anything that you set your mind to. Do you guys believe that? Do you really?
Absolutely.
Like, if you believe that, if you believe that you're a creator, that you can create anything that you set your mind to, like, you'll be an amazing entrepreneur. It's that simple. Like, most of the work happens right here in your own head. And I'm going to walk you through it. But think back to, you know, the time. Do you guys remember the Kennedy speech when he declared something to the world? What was that speech?
Man on the moon.
If you rewind about 20 years before that speech happened, you will have seen cartoons and TV shows imagining the possibility of a man on the moon. Before Kennedy ever said the words, we were imagining it, and we didn't really understand it. We didn't know what it really looked like. And in the cartoons, you'll see, you know, this man on the moon without a helmet on. Like, you know, there are gaps in their understanding of what it would take and what it would actually be like, but the imagination was there. Like, they imagined what it could be. And then it was 20 years later that Kennedy created a transformation of that idea. He took that imagination and made a declaration. And the declaration was his vision of what they were committed to creating here in this country. And he said, we're going to do it, not because it's easy, but because it's hard. And what it's going to do for our nation to show that we can accomplish something that great for our country, and what it would mean for our knowledge and our science and our understanding of the world around us. And he declared it, and he didn't know how it was going to happen. He couldn't connect the dots from where they were at that moment in time to what it would take to actually get the man on the moon. But it only took 7 years, and we landed a man on the moon and took that first step and created a footprint on the surface of the moon that forever has changed our understanding of this universe. And more importantly, taught us that we can do that. We can replicate that pattern in our lives, in our businesses, in our organizations every day. And that's what I just find incredibly inspiring and amazing about the entrepreneurial journey. As an entrepreneur, you have that exact same opportunity to use your imagination to form a declaration of what you intend to create, and then you use leadership to inspire other people around that cause and execute. And over time, it turns into creation. And that's it. That's the journey. And if you just love the sound of that, you should be an entrepreneur, because that's the job. Isn't that awesome? Like, I just love it. It just makes me, like, there's nothing I would rather do in the world than be a creator. And I think it's because it's the very essence, in my view, in my vision of humanity, of why we're here. Like, it's to learn how to create. That's what we do. And so the entrepreneurial journey is very connected to that. And it's really powerful. It's really kind of spiritual in some ways for many of us. So that was my preamble. And I want you to anchor in that in your mind, in your mind's eye, as we kind of walk through this. Like, hold on to that thought. And I'm going to get a little more concrete here as we talk about the four things I've learned in starting Pluralsight, which is a company that's located here in Utah, up in Farmington. We're one of the few tech companies north of Salt Lake City. There is fun in Farmington besides Lagoon. It's where fun is, and part of it's found at Pluralsight. And so when you go up there, when you drive up to Lagoon, if you just look across the freeway, we're just right on the other side of that. And it's an amazing little place. A lot of people kind of refer to it. You guys had Corinne Clark here last week speaking. She calls it the Truman Show, because it kind of feels like you're in this little fake world, because it's just so nice. It's just so beautiful. And we have amazing restaurants and just manicured, you know, grounds and all this amazing stuff there. So it's a really cool place to come visit us sometime. Come tour the office and check it out. Pluralsight is a company focused on changing the world. And I know you've probably heard a lot of people say that, but you're going to get a real sense for what I mean by that here in just a couple of minutes. We do it by giving technology skills to people, and we embed those skills in people in a way that they can then go create things for the world that make the world a better place. That's in a nutshell what we do as a company. And we do it through an online library of amazing courses that you would want to, you know, take after you're done with your degrees here at UVU. And in fact, I think we're working on partnerships, and there are some professors that may be using it now, I can't remember. But it's relevant skills in the workplace. So if you're a software developer, an IT professional, if you're working with technology in any way, we have over 6,000 courses that you can, you know, come and take on our website for $29 a month. And it will give you skills that you can use in today's most high-demand technology professions. And we sell to both individuals as well as to the biggest companies in the world, and have a lot of fun doing it. So that's what we are, and that's what we do. And I'm going to give you four critical steps here that I've learned over my 13-year journey with the company. We were founded in 2004. That have led to our success and ultimately what I think are the core ingredients in creating high growth. Does that sound fun? Okay, so we got about a half an hour to go through this, then we'll do questions. So here's just a little timeline of the company. Started in 2004, didn't raise any money until 2012. A lot of people think you have to raise money to build a company. My co-founders and I each put $5,000 into our joint bank account. And that was our seed capital. That was it. It was the only money we ever put into the business for the first 10 years of the company, almost. And then we raised money. And it wasn't until we actually had figured out the product and the product market fit that we decided it made sense to raise money. So it's like in that moment when you realize you have something that can grow, and now you want to throw fuel on the fire. And that's the best possible moment to raise funds from investors. And because we did it so late in our life cycle, we were able to maintain control of our company. So today we've raised over $200 million in funding for the company, and the founders still control the company. And we only have one investor on our board. And we have four independent directors, two founders, only one investor. And it's a wonderful place to be. No offense to any investors in the room. I'm an investor too now, and there are good investors. But you don't want to lose control of your idea too soon. That's the main thing. And so, like, that was a path we took. There's a few other companies in Utah who have taken similar paths who will come and speak to you if they haven't already. And, you know, that's one of the common things about Utah, because there hasn't been a lot of venture capital here in the States, so a lot of companies have been forced to take a path like this, and which was a great thing. I actually feel blessed that that's what happened here with me, because it put me in a place where we can control our mission for a long time to come. And that's really important to me because I care about my creation. My creation is my life. You know, it really means something to me. So after we raised the money, we realized we had a market opportunity to go consolidate a bunch of companies under one brand. And so we bought 8 companies over a 2.5-year window. And they were all companies doing similar things to us, but we were a little bit ahead of all of them. But at the time, it didn't look like we were that ahead. Like the first company we bought, which was called Train Signal, was doing IT training. We were doing software development training. We wanted to expand from software to IT, and they were the leader. And we were only a little bit bigger than them. They were about $7 million in revenue, and we were probably $16 million in revenue at the time. But we got a deal done because of our vision and because of where we were at in executing on our creation. Like the power of our vision made us look and seem, and actually we became much bigger than this other company. Can you see that? And it just changed everything. And then the dominoes just started to fall and everything fell into place. And it was that trajectory of acquiring all these companies that put us into an amazing market position to be the leader in technology training. And it's helped as part of this. But I'm just framing this so you can kind of see like what Pluralsight is. We were just a few software developers that came together around this idea, didn't have any business experience really. Experience and to some degree, even formal education is highly overrated. Like it's important. And it does a lot of good for you. I have a computer science degree, but it's not necessary all the time. What's much more important is how you learn how to learn. That's what this institution is really about for me. It teaches you how to learn. And then the people who really win and create are the ones who can learn most quickly throughout the rest of their lives. So these are the 4 things that I've learned in creating Pluralsight. You need a compelling mission and vision. You need a strong culture, a differentiated strategy, and operational excellence. And if you put those 4 things together, you get high growth. And a lot of companies are really good at one of them, but not all of them. Or they might be good at 2 or 3 of them, but not all 4. And the truly great companies are the ones who can create all 4 of these things at the same time. Does that make sense? So let's double click into each of these 4 things and talk about what they really mean. So what does it mean to create a compelling mission and vision? What's a mission? A mission. What is a mission? And how's a mission separate from a vision? How are they different? Language is important. And on this whole theme of creation, I want you to just think for a second about what actually creates. Language creates. President Holland here is one of the most skilled orators that I've listened to. He has command of language, as does his father. I can tell. And language, they're great examples of how language creates. I want you to just think about that for a second. You guys have seen the movie Inception, some of you? Okay, so what's the movie about? It's about the idea, the inception of an idea in your brain, right? And once it's there, you can't get rid of it. Like that's creation. Right? What creates ideas in our brains? Language. So language is the source of creation. And the reason I'm hitting on this, it's a really profound point. I hope you write that down, because that one thought is incredibly powerful as you think about what you intend to create in your lives. when you think about your mission as an entrepreneur is the reason you're going to do what you're going to do, the reason you're doing what you're doing, the reason you're committed to creating what you intend to create, the why behind your idea. That's your mission. And that's the thing that never really changes through the life cycle of your company if you get really clear on it early on. Sometimes missions evolve over time because you can see bigger possibilities over your trajectory, but the true essence behind it doesn't change. Like, it's the why you do what you do. And it's incredibly powerful. At Pluralsight, our mission, the thing we're most committed to, the reason we exist as a company, is to create progress for the world through technology that lifts the human condition. That's why we exist. That's why I work as hard as I work every day for this company. And it touches lives around us everywhere. I want you to just reflect for a moment in your own minds on how your lives have been touched by technology in some way. Reflect and think about what it was like as long back as you can remember. Some of you aren't even old enough to think back 20 years. But like, when I remember what it was like 20 years ago and what my existence was like, and I think about what it's like today and I think about technology's role in creating that, it gives me a clear sense for what we do for the world. Pluralsight is committed to creating technology, skills, and people that can then go out into the world and create new things that lift mankind, that make our lives better. And that's what we're committed to as a company. That will never change. And we really believe in it. We organize our lives around it. We create the creators in the world that use technology to create. And that's my mission. That's my life's work. It's what I've dedicated my entire lifetime to, and will for the rest of my life. Because it creates so much good, and it touches so many lives, and it's just something that I can't stop thinking about. And as an entrepreneur, when you become that committed to something, success is inevitable. It's not a question anymore. It's inevitable because there's so much power in your mission. Is that clear? There's so much power in a mission. And there's so much power in language that's used to describe it. I've spent years thinking about words like this to articulate what this mission means to me. And I'm still not done because I know there's probably even a more powerful way. But that's what's so fun about this work. So when you have a mission, that's your anchor, that's your moral compass, that's your North Star. And then you have to create vision around it. Vision is how you take a mission and start making declarations about what you intend to create that will get you closer to your mission. So it's actually putting more work and more thought and more language into the creation of your mission. Does that make sense? I'm using my language very carefully here. Vision is the declaration of what you intend to create. At Pluralsight, we have an incredibly clear and concise 2020 vision. I'm wearing the hoodie right now to represent it. Everyone across our company knows what we intend to create by December 31st, 2020. It's the Man on the Moon Declaration. We say by December 31st, 2020, we will be the global leader in closing the technology skills gap. Pluralsight will be synonymous with closing the technology skills gap. We will have 1 million paid active learners on our platform and 5 million free active learners on our platform across a variety of underprivileged demographics. And we will have dedicated 1% of our time, profit, and equity to this mission, to creating more technology skills in the world through partners and other groups that are aligned with our mission. And those are the main nuggets of our vision. And then we have a bunch of additional declarations that apply to each group across the company with other metrics about what we're going to create. So everyone in the company knows what they're responsible for creating by December 31st, 2020. It's different than goals. Goals are similar, but it's a little bit different. You're committing to an act of creation. And you're envisioning it, you're seeing it, and you can't see the dots all the way there. They're not all connected. Like, if they were all connected in your mind when you created the vision, guess what? You're not thinking hard enough. Like, you're not creating big enough. Like, you shouldn't be able to see the connection from where you're at today to where you intend to go. If you can, it's not big enough. Does that make sense? Like, you have to stretch it. And then the work is connecting the dots. So at Pluralsight, every two years, we declare a vision. This is our 2020 vision. And then 2 years from now, we'll declare our 2022 vision. And then our 2024 vision. And then every 4 years, we hold ourselves accountable to the vision we created 4 years ago. And we see what we created, what we didn't create, and why, and we learn, and we grow. And the vision is always the thing pulling us to what? To our mission. Does that make sense? There's a lot of power in that. And guess what? This doesn't just apply to business. My son is currently serving a mission down in Argentina, and I asked him for his 2017 vision. Like, what do you intend to create for yourself in 2017? And he just sent it to me on Tuesday. Or sorry, on Monday. They can't use the computer on Tuesday, just so you know. It's amazing. Like, he sent me his vision for himself, what he intends to create. And now I can see it. And guess what? Because I can see it now, I can support him. And I can coach him. I can help him. But I'm not forcing him, because it's his vision. It's the vision he has for himself that's pulling him forward. And I'm just there to support him. There are powerful lessons in parenthood here. Like, if you apply this to your lives with your kids and your children, like, you will never have to discipline them again. Like, if you can really master this. Like, it's incredibly powerful. And it applies to every aspect of life. Like, you can apply this principle to anything you intend to create. So that's ours. We got some really clear metrics. Pluralsight is committed to this. And in 2020, if you see me again, I want you to ask me how we did. Okay, will you do that? Yeah. Awesome. So then, after you have a vision, you then have to get it down to closer to earth. Like, okay, so now what are we going to actually do in 2017? And especially right now in Q1, the first quarter of the year, and even more important, like right now in February. And so you got to create some playbooks. Your playbooks are the things that get the whole company aligned around what you're going to do to go execute on that vision. So you have a mission. Imagine the mission above the vision. And then you have your 2020 vision, which supports your mission. And then you break it down to annual playbooks. Here's what we're going to do in 17, 18, 19, 20. And then each year, you break it down into quarterly themes, goals, and rocks. Rocks are objectives. Have you heard the Stephen Covey analogy of rocks in a vase? Like, if you have a bunch of rocks and pebbles and sand, and you put all the sand and pebbles in first, all the rocks won't fit in. They'll fall out the top because you didn't leave enough room for them. And so you really want to get the most important things in first. So you put the rocks in first and then fill in with all the pebbles and sand. And so as a company, you want to treat your objectives that way. You want to understand what are the most important things that you need to go execute on first to achieve your vision. And then those become your quarterly rocks. And then you make sure you get all those things in first every quarter. And then the rest, you just fill in the rest as you can. And if you do that and you execute across all these plans, across all these quarters, guess what you get? You get your vision. So you take the vision and you break it down. You're just breaking it down. That's it. And you see what you can see right now. I have a powerful formula that I want you to write down because it's not in the slides. And this is something my father-in-law taught me a long time ago and has touched me my whole life. Bless me. Goal plus plan equals power. Just write it down. Goal plus plan equals power. If you have a vision or a goal, and then you plan how you're going to go achieve it, it produces power. And that power is in the form of excitement. You'll start to feel excited about it. You'll start to feel motivated. And then as you start working and progressing, you see the results, and it turns into an amazing thing. And you just build more power. And so this is the process of taking your vision and then adding plans to it. And once you have all that in place, it produces power in your company. Everyone knows what to do. Everyone knows how to succeed. And then it's just the execution of all those quarterly rocks and objectives that create your vision, which is aligned with your mission. Does that make sense? It's awesome. Oh, love this stuff. Okay. Second thing, and I'm going to be more efficient on these next three. The first one is by far the most important. So I've dedicated my time to that one. The next three are also important, but it all kind of stems off of the first one. Like, you've got to really be anchored on that. The second thing is to build a strong culture based on core values. What is it that your organization really stands for? At Pluralsight, we look for truth seekers, entrepreneurs, and eternal optimists to join our company. And we're really clear on that. We know what those values mean in terms of behaviors, like how people show up, how they interact with each other. It guides our hiring and our firing of people. We're committed to maintaining an organizational DNA based on those core values. And it keeps us aligned because we believe those core values will help us achieve our mission and our 2020 vision. The culture is subservient to that. It serves the purpose of what you intend to create. And we think those core values are the most important things to find in people who will really thrive and succeed in helping us achieve our mission at Pluralsight. And as a company, it's really important to get clear on this. Because if you don't get clear on this, you're just going to start hiring people, and a bunch of them aren't going to work for what you're committed to creating. Like, just like anything else, you have to be clear on the design of the people that you want to bring into your organization. And you have to get clear on what that design looks like in terms of values and behaviors associated with those values. And if you can get really clear on that, then when you're interviewing someone, it becomes pretty clear and apparent quickly, like, does this person fit what we're looking for or not? And you won't always get it right. You'll make mistakes. But when you do, you can correct them. Because now you have an entire organization committed to that set of core values, and they will hold the organization accountable to it. So when they see behaviors that are not aligned with it, guess what? They'll tell you. They'll actually weed it out. It's like rejecting a bad organ. You know, like, they won't let it stay. And so getting really clear on this, and again, there's, remember what I said before about power and language. Like, when you can use language to encapsulate the feeling and the thought behind what you intend to create in your people in your people systems. Like you are creating. You're creating who's going to be there in your walls. And it just took a few words to get that really clear. Do you see the power in that? I could spend an hour talking about each one of these, but I'm not going to because it's not useful at this moment. But if any of you come to Pluralsight and interview, you're going to hear a lot about these. And we actually have a great video. If you go to pluralsight.com/careers, you can watch a video right there from the voice of our people about what these values mean to them. Okay? The other thing to remember is there's tremendous power in leadership. And values requires leadership to get right. And we think we spend a lot of time as a company thinking about leadership. Leadership is incredibly important and another aspect of values that's critical. Number three, you need to execute on a differentiated strategy. What's unique about you in the world? What's your purple cow? You guys read that book or heard of that book? You need to stand out because you're creating value for the world in some way. And that's an important part of building a successful high-growth business. If you don't really stand out, if there's nothing different about you, you know, then it's going to be hard to be noticed, and it's going to be hard for people to care. You know, so again, mission, and then how do you create a market position for yourself? By looking around you, what exists in this problem space, and like, where do you want to position your company? And again, it comes back to language. What language are you going to use to describe that to the world so everyone remembers who you are? And it affects your marketing strategies, your sales strategies, your go-to-market model, and there's tremendous power in that. So you need to be differentiated. Pluralsight is the only company in the world that is 100% dedicated and focused on technology learning. There's no one else in the market dedicated to it like us. We only have two big competitors, Skillsoft, which is the big one in the enterprise space, and lynda.com, which is in the consumer space. Lynda is mass consumer. They have some tech, but they have a lot of non-tech. And Skillsoft has a lot of non-tech as well, mostly compliance, leadership, soft skills. Pluralsight occupies the place of being the only technology-oriented, technology-dedicated learning platform for professionals. And that's our differentiated strategy. We could choose to go into soft skills. We could choose to go into leadership. We choose not to, because that's not what we want to create right now at this moment in time, given our strategy. Okay? So differentiated strategy. We break that strategy down into a lot of detail. So we know, have you guys ever seen one of these before? This is a strategic roadmap that tells you where you're going to play as a company, and more importantly, where you're not going to play. Knowing where you're not going to go is harder to figure out than knowing where you're going to go. Can I tell you how many times I get phone calls from people in China wanting us to go to China? And guess what? China, according to this map, is not in the footprint. So I don't have to take any of those phone calls. And think about the amount of time I'm saving. Like, I know that doesn't make sense. And I know that in the 2017 timeframe, there's a certain amount of things that make sense in terms of adjacencies we're going to move into. And there's some that are going to be more like the 2019 or 2020 timeframe. And we're kind of looking ahead and filling it out and trying to be really smart about where we're going to go. Where are we going to play and how are we going to win? We don't want to go places where we can't win. So I'm going to pick the best places to go where I know I can win. Does that make sense? Huge value in getting this right. Okay, last thing. Achieve operational excellence. You know, all that stuff about mission, vision, culture, strategy gives you the DNA you need to be successful. Then you have to just get really good at executing with efficiency. You have to become best in class at everything you do. People, processes, tools, systems. And this is the thing that usually comes last. It's the thing that Pluralsight's focused on right now the most. Because once you become successful, you then have to get more efficient at it. How do I tighten it up? How do I make sure we're making best use of our resources, our money? How do I get more out of each dollar we invest? And that's another fun aspect of the problem. And when you put all four of those things together, it produces high growth. And it's an amazing journey, and it will be the most rewarding experience of your lives. And there's so many lessons in this talk that can apply to your lives today, whether you're starting a company right now or not. You can apply these same principles to anything that you do. Can you see that? Can you see that possibility? Awesome. Thank you for having me. It's been awesome to be here.